Would you pray with me, please? Again, Father, we call upon you that through these words that we would hear you speaking to us, that we would understand better, and that we would understand the call that you are calling us with, that you are speaking to us here. Even if we are dealing with things that are difficult for us, that go against our flesh, help us to be committed to you always, as Jesus is committed to that mission. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, as I mentioned earlier, tonight we begin this Lenten series, which is entitled Behold the Man. Now, you may recall that those were the words that Pilate spoke of Jesus when he called Jesus before that very unforgiving and unfriendly crowd. Of course, this was after Jesus had already been flogged. He already had that crown of thorns jammed onto his head. So at that point, he was quite bloodied and beaten. They also arrayed him with a purple robe, and they mocked him as the king of the Jews. So this was the Jesus that Pilate paraded before these people when he said to them, "Behold the man." Well, this Lenten season, we're going to take Pilate's advice. We're going to take the time, make the effort to behold the man. And the reason why we're going to do this is because even though we may not forget the fact, we have a tendency to just skim right over that fact, to treat that fact so lightly. And the fact that I'm talking about is that Jesus is a man. You see, we have a tendency to look at Jesus and to see him purely as God, which he is. He is God. We cannot deny that. He is part of that Trinity. But he is also man. And that's the part I think we tend to gloss over a little. He had flesh and bones. He has skin, eyes, ears, nose, mouth, hands, fingers, toes, everything. Head and shoulders, knees and toes, all of that. He is man. And so what we're going to do here is we're going to take a look at how Jesus endured everything that he went through as a man, as he set his eyes on that and set his course on that cross where he suffered and bled and died for us. So I'm going to need something from you folks. Tonight and throughout this whole series, I want you to really focus in on the fact that Jesus is fully a man. Okay? Yes, he's God. We got that down pat, I think. But he is fully a man, but without sin. You see, his human nature, that was absolutely perfect. It was unstained. It was unspoiled by Adam's rebellion. And it really is, as the author of Hebrews writes, he writes this, he says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." Okay, what's that all saying is that Jesus is as human can be. You got that? He is man, but without sin. Okay, that's the prelude for all of this. Now, tonight we begin to behold the man by looking at Jesus as a man who hungers. Yes, he is God who hungers, but he is a man who hungers as well. Now, you probably recall, and we were singing a little of it in the last hymn there, but you recall after Jesus' baptism, he was taken by the Spirit, moved by the Spirit to go out into the wilderness where he was going to be tempted by the devil, by Satan. While he was out there, he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Do you remember that? Well, in both Matthew's gospel and Luke's gospel, it tells us that when this fast was over, Jesus was hungry. Duh. I mean, of course he was hungry. You think, okay, why did these guys write that in there? But I think it was for a reason. You see, for God to not eat for 40 days, is that a big deal? For God not to eat for 40 days. I'm glad you recanted on that. That's good. Is God spirit? Does God eat? I've never seen it. However, God in the flesh, who needs to eat in order to live, who needs to eat in order to survive, boy, for him to not eat for 40 days, that is huge. That is enormous. For God in the flesh, for God who is also man, for him not to eat, that is huge. I mean, just think about it. How many of you have fasted for 40 days? In fact, I'm going to ask that. I want to, by a show of hands, how many of you have fasted? And I'm talking about a legitimate fast, no food for 40 days. If you have done that, please raise your hand. That's what I thought. Okay. In fact, usually when I ask that question, people say, can a person even survive if they don't eat for 40 days? And the answer to that, all those in Bible study on Sunday, the answer to that, you better believe they can. Now, it all depends on how healthy they are. It also depends on the amount of stored up body fat and muscle mass and all of that. But generally, a healthy person can withstand a 40-day fast. Doctors even say, and I don't know, it said, at least that's what I read, doctors even say that a normal healthy person can go about 8 weeks, 56 days without eating, providing that they have water. They stay hydrated, the liquids, the fluids, provided that. But they can go 56 days without food. That's crazy. Now, getting back to the Bible. In the Bible, there really are, I don't know if you've ever studied that, but there really are quite a few different kinds of fasts that the Bible brings up. And there is one that we tend to call a normal fast. And I think the reason why we call it that is because this is the fast that the people normally do. So hence we have a normal fast. Doesn't that make sense? Okay, what this normal fast is that it's abstaining from all food for that certain designated period of time, but not from water, not from fluids. Okay, not from whatever they're drinking there. So they do that. And that was the most common of the fast. That was a normal fast. Now, if you look at Jesus out in that wilderness, he fasted for those 40 days. Never brings up water, never brings up the fact that he was thirsty, even though in the hymn that we just sang, it brought it up. But it never brings that up. So this is, he just talks about how he was hungry. So this is why many scholars, many theologians believe that this was a normal fast that Jesus was going through. However, you know, we don't know that. It could have been a supernatural fast. A supernatural fast, for example, is what we see in Exodus, where Moses was up on that mountain with God for 40 days. But that specifically said that Moses did not eat or drink. It brought in that. So there, he would have been dead if God did not intervene. So that was a supernatural fast. I just wanted to bring this up so that you could understand it. It really, that's not the important part here. The important part here is, why did Jesus fast in the first place? Now, let's take a look at this from our perspective. For us as Christians, first of all, how many of you have ever fasted for a spiritual reason, not because you have to get ready for a test or surgery or something like that? How many of you have ever fasted for a spiritual Christian reason? If you have, raise your hand. Okay, so you know what it's like. But for us Christians, fasting is about denying ourselves in order to seek God. Now try to get that picture. Denying our flesh, denying what our flesh desires, denying what our flesh wants, in order that we can focus more clearly on our Lord, more clearly on this relationship with Him, more clearly on our spiritual life with Him. So what fasting does, its purpose is really a preparation for us. It prepares us in seeking God. It prepares us for opening our life up even more for God. And it's a great preparation. Well, if you look at Jesus here, he was going through a preparation as well while he was out there fasting. He just had been baptized. He had not started his ministry yet. And so this was preparation time for him. He was, this discipline, this testing was really helping to prepare him for his ministry and everything else that followed. Now, of course, when Jesus fasted, he was physically weakened. If you've ever seen someone who's fasted for a long period of time, they are very, very severely physically weakened. But even in that weakened condition, Jesus did not succumb to Satan's temptations. See, that's the great thing. He stood strong. I think we tend to pass off these temptations as, oh, Jesus handled it. He was God. No, he was man. And he was weak in this situation, but he still stood his ground. He was true to his Father. He was true to God's word. He was true to this mission of going to the cross to free us from our slavery to sin. So what does this really show us? It shows us that God in Christ Jesus, in the man Jesus, God knows what hunger is like far, far better than you and I who have never fasted for 40 days. Don't you think? He knows what hunger is like. My point is, Jesus knows what we go through in our life. Jesus has experienced what we go through in our life because he is a man as well as being God. In this case, he knew what his flesh desired, but still he denied that flesh. He denied that desire. Now, what I want you to get from this is that Jesus fasted for you. I want you to understand that he fasted for you. So once again, it's all about you, right? It's all about you. That's why he did this. He denied what his flesh desired. He endured all that temptation without sinning. Why? Because he wanted to be the one. He wanted to be the man who would go to that cross and lay down his life for you to redeem you. He wanted to be your substitute on that cross, your perfect, absolute perfect substitute, the perfect man dying for you. That's what this fast was really all about you. It pointed to his mission. It pointed to the cross. It pointed to you. Everything. Now think about that, okay? Now we've got that picture of Jesus. Now let's take a look at us. In that gospel reading that we had tonight, Matthew's gospel, it talks about a few things there. It brings up giving to the needy, it brings up prayer, and it brings up fasting, doesn't it? All three of these are a part of worshiping God. All of them are part of worshiping God. All three of them are expected by God. We are expected by God to do all three. Jesus, did he say, if you pray or if you give to the needy? No, he's saying, when you pray, when you give to the needy, when you fast. So all of this is expected by God. He expects us as part of our worship to do this. Okay, there's more. You're going to get so excited about this. In Lent, which is, of course, is not in the Bible. No, Lent, of course, is never mentioned in the Bible at all. It comes centuries later. But the purpose for Lent is to prepare us in our 40 days here. It's to prepare us to really dwell on what Jesus has done, to dwell on his death and his resurrection, to celebrate the impact that he has on our life. We focus on this so much more. We focus at this time of the year to prepare us so much more so that the Lord God can make even more of an impact on our life and have a new and different meaning in our life. This is really what Lent is all about. And even though Lent is not found in the Bible anywhere, still it takes its principles from Scripture and it takes its disciplines from Scripture. In fact, historically, the disciplines of Lent, which there are three of them, the main disciplines of Lent, does anybody want to guess what those three disciplines of Lent are? Anybody want to give it a shot? The three disciplines of Lent. Okay, I'll give you a hint. I just told you what they were. Okay, those are the three disciplines of Lent. Giving to the needy, prayer, and fasting. All three are to be part of our Lenten journey here. All three. Now, I think all of us can get behind prayer, right? We're all for prayer. I think we can get behind giving to the needy. We do that all the time, don't we? This congregation is so generous. So how about fasting? How are you doing with that? Not so well? No, we don't do fasting well. We really haven't embraced fasting at all. I don't know, maybe we think it's too legalistic for us. Or maybe we think it's too physical to be spiritual. I don't think that's the case. I have my own thoughts on this, and I want to share. These are my thoughts, but I get these from looking at my own life, and I assume it's pretty much the same for you. Do you want to know why I have such a difficult time fasting and why I think you have such a difficult time fasting? It's because of the fact that our flesh has way, way too much control over us. That's the reason, at least for me. Is it the same for you? Does your flesh have way, way too much control over you for you to even consider fasting? Our flesh says no way to that. And we don't go against our flesh, do we? That's why I think we have such a tough time fasting. But you know, that's exactly why we should fast. And that's exactly why I'm encouraging all of you to fast, unless those of you for health reasons cannot do it. So don't come blaming me for that. No, I don't want those with health problems to fast. But for all of us who can fast, I'm encouraging you to do that during this time, this season of Lent. I want you to work on fasting for the purpose of disciplining your flesh. See, this is important. Lent is not goof-off time, okay? I want you to work on fasting for the purpose of disciplining your flesh. Let me just explain that. As you learn to control your belly, your stomach, that's going to help you to discipline yourself in those other areas of your life with your flesh. It's going to help you to discipline those. Now, with every person, it's different. It may be you're not disciplined in food, or maybe drinking, or drugs, or maybe smoking. Now, I know we've got smokers here today, and you know very well, is it sinful or whatever? It's not good for you. It's going to kill you, okay? I promise you, it will kill you. So that's something that really needs to get out of your life, okay? But it's something like that, or maybe something like, maybe it's anger in you. Maybe it's laziness. Maybe it's worldliness. Maybe it's lust. Maybe it's a self-centeredness. This is your issue with flesh. Well, if you fast, that discipline of fasting can also help you discipline those other areas of your flesh. It can do that. I've tried it. It works, really. I'm not an expert, but I tried it. Now, so what I'm encouraging you to do is fast. And let your growling stomach, let your rumbling hunger teach you that your belly is not your God. Let it teach you that your flesh is not your God. I'm serious, folks. Too often we have let our flesh be our God. And we cannot do that. And this is what helps us. This fasting is what helps us. It's your homework assignment. What do you think? You're going to give it a shot? Please, please, I'm just begging you to try it. Maybe just try one day a week or one day a month. Maybe just try it one time during one day, one 24-hour period where you do a normal fast. Don't try this supernatural fast, okay? Do the normal fast. Try it. With the purpose of seeking God, of disciplining your flesh to follow God. Just give it a shot. Folks, this Lenten season, I don't want you to just slide through this Lenten season. All too often we do that. We just got, we come to Ash Wednesday and say, see you on Good Friday, or something like that. I don't want it to slide. I want you to really take a very, very close look at Jesus and behold the man. Behold not just the God, but behold the man who fasted for you. The man who ministers to you. The man who sacrificed himself on that cross for you. And the man who rose to life again for you. You see, Jesus, he succeeded in all this where we have failed miserably time and time again. But because Jesus has succeeded in doing this as God and as man, because of that, right now, today, you and I, we can live in this incredible freedom of forgiveness where doubts and fears and worries have no part of our life. We can live in this amazing relationship where we are restored to the Almighty God as His children, where He is our dad, where we know His peace and know His comfort, and we can have this amazing, incredible hope in us of everlasting life and heaven as our home for all eternity. We can have this because of Jesus, the man. And so this Lenten season, behold the man. Look at him. Listen to him. Learn from him. And really worship him with your whole being. Let's pray about that now. Father, open our hearts to you. All too often, Lord, we let self win. We let flesh win. Lord, today, let us make a stand. Whatever it is that we need to abandon, help us to abandon. Help us to fast from that. And Lord, if we choose to fast for you, to fast from food, give us the strength to focus on you, the purpose for it, to be brought closer to you, to be more open to you and to your will in our life. Lord, I'm asking that during this Lenten season, you would work on all of us. Your Spirit would be poured out on every single one of us as we behold the man, your Son and our Savior. It is in His name that I pray. Amen.